After a lunch. We've got to review what we've called the social policy block, which in this case includes health, education, employment, social protection and equality policies. And then Nacho would tell us about the exterior policy block, which includes peace, security, cooperation, and relations. The idea is to do the same as this morning, not so much talk about the total amount of variables, but emphasize some elements that are still of concern to us and explain what the limits have been in some limitations have been in some cases, and what we've focused on, how we've interpreted things based on what the key elements are that those policies can give us from the framework of development policies. And we'll have time for debate, and then we'll finish with a presentation by Hector, I don't know whether Shirley, on indicators, presenting the full matrix of all the indicators in the index and what have you. Best thing, let's go back then to the social policies. I think that in contrast with other blocks that we've spoken about and seen, the exterior one, I think it's just one slide. In contrast with other blocks as regards social policy, there are secondary sources, very significant secondary sources because of the number of countries, and probably as a result of, of the international development system and institutions that are devoted to social development. And by virtue of some international agreements, there's been quite a development of indicators, variables, and a lot of debate about the key factors that have made it much easier to analyze these policies as compared to others. However, some of the elements that we wanted to measure and incorporate in the measurement of each of those policies are still not represented clearly in those sources. It's true that part of the work that we've had to do, for instance, in education policy, is to select data from an economy point of view for the compound index, because fortunately there are many data, a lot of them quite standardized and comparable for practically all the countries in the world on many, many different types of indicators, to measure the type of system of education, to measure the social public expense associated with those measures, what concept of education prevails in terms of public policy, whether it's a service, it's a service linked to law, law in the community. Some are sounder, some are less sound, but it's not the same as in other areas where we're kind of lost in no man's land. But it's also true that there's a heterogeneity, a mix, degree of variety in the data that we use for our indicators, education quality variables. But in Europe, the most frequent ones are really focus on how much education benefits the student. That's what the PISA report is based on. Level of knowledge, mathematics, ability, mathematical ability, and the literacy levels or language levels. Those data are not available for all countries, although there have been regional initiatives through CEPAL, for instance. It was an OECD program strictly when it began, but it's not consistent all over the place, and the data cannot be applied everywhere equally. But there are other quality indicators about the ratio of students to teachers or teachers to students, etc. And in this election, when we looked at selecting the data, we tried to bear in mind, to take into consideration the aspects which the literature tells us are essential to measure the ability for social advancement resulting from the education system. And we've incorporated indicators like the public to private spending ratio, also demographics. We also broke down most of the data there. Most of the data are broken down into genders, and there hasn't been too much of a problem. There was in the environmental dimension, I think, if I remember rightly, it was health, or somebody said about this as regards the health policy in the environmental area. We were very eager to incorporate a datum which was average distance to schools, which is finally available for very few countries and is not very reliable. So we've had to do away with that. Within the environmental factors, the amount that the distance of schools is also relevant. In the case of health indicators, something similar happens. They're not really so extensive or detailed, but there are enough for what we want to measure. And the same applies to the selection. An example is that there are several indicators relative to sexual health and reproductive health, and we thought it was interesting to include unsatisfied contraception measures, that variable. The use of contraception, and that one we thought would show the situations where that demand is not covered or satisfied. We applied the same logic, expense, public expense, indicators, type of system, quality of the system, with the indicators that are available. And in terms of equality policy, we combined aspects having to do with the salary gap or the pay gap. People might say this belongs to gender employment, but we decided to put it in the economic area of the equality policy. There are several examples where things overlap or are moved from one area to another to make things coherent internally and well balanced. And one was a database developed by the World Bank, which is very interesting, which gives us derivatives from classic data that had to do with the Millennium Objectives, the number of women MPs, women within government, but specifically through an analysis of legislation, corporate legislation, we could say, in the different countries. And that gives us data about how easy or difficult it is for women to conciliate, to access their the employment market in that area, etc., the equality policy, inequality also, discrimination, sexual discrimination, crimes per capita, rape, in the LGBT collectives and communities. The two policies within this block that have satisfied less are those that have to do with employment and social protection. As regards employment, both policies have a fundamental database, which is the Social Protection Atlas, which is published by the World Bank. That's a statistic effort that's been going for a few years, and they've put in a very wide, extensive database, they've put a lot of the aspects of protection, social protection coverage in terms of percentage of salaries of pensions, temporary coverage as regards or as compared or as associated with salaries for unemployment. It measures an enormous amount of indicators and many aspects that have to do with social protection systems, what type of system, if it's universal, if it's restricted to the military or to civil servants or any other sector in each country, and it allows us to select indicators and set up gauging systems. The problem with the Atlas is that it only is for emerging countries. I think the last edition they spoke about 115, 117 countries, only emerging countries. The World Bank 4 or 5 years ago, has been now for 4 or 5 years saying that it's going to standardize these data with data from the OECD on the protection systems and what have you to give us a world picture. We've written to the relevant bureau and they've told us that that's not yet been done. We're trying to see whether with our limited abilities or capacities, we can set up some kind of parallels between the OECD and the World Bank data. The OECD are better quality data, but it's a problem of standardization. The result of that, if we're successful and we get these data standardized, will be that, for instance, for activists or experts in social service policies in countries like ours, the data will be are not enough, deep enough. They're not far-ranging enough. The degree of knowledge is not so deep. There are other techniques like the Naropi techniques that are used through Eurostat in Europe. There's a degree of knowledge of the social system, but that's impossible to have here for us, for enough countries in the world. That doesn't mean to say that we're not satisfied with the framework of this Atlas database. It is satisfactory, but it sometimes lacks depth. And as regards employment, well, as we said at the beginning, the main problems have to do with the fact that we've tried to make an effort to incorporate situations that usually are left outside the surveys of employment. You know that the International Trade Organization tells us, or Employment Organization tells us, that more than half of the employment in the world is not definite, not fixed employment, not stable employment, but then if you look at all other kinds of aspects that have to do with work and that surround employment, care, supports, facilities, etc., etc. And when you look at the realities of workers who are below the poverty threshold, well, all that we want to also put in the indicators. so that we can have a picture of employment policy that goes beyond the traditional concept and is more associated with the idea, the concept of decent, dignified employment, to see what countries, how they behave in terms of that, what their percentage of decent, dignified employment is, and what percentage of work, although it is legal, is not really cannot be considered decent, and then what they have in terms of non-remunerated work or employment too. There's a significant effort that we have to make there. The International Employment Organization has made efforts in this regard. They've looked at different countries. It's interesting to look at the working poor database, which builds an indicator based on the rates of employment and cross-reference those rates with the rates of relative poverty. This has been done in Spain very successfully in terms of communication and information, because it revealed a discussion or a situation that was not known about when we talk about bare statistics of employment, because there's often a situation of loss of rights. But unfortunately, there are not data for enough countries as we, in terms of what we need, and we're not going to be able to incorporate that. We're going to make up for the data that we don't have by using certain legislative thresholds that have to do with signed agreements and resolutions of the International Employment Organization or International Work Organization. And they offer data, and allow us to get closer to the concept that we want to use to measure this area. And those are the most, I think, important, outstanding points and the greatest difficulties that we've had. As in any, in all other situations, we try to combine commitment and the aim of achieving a preliminary version that is, or a first version that is good enough. But we consider that this is still an open program, and we hope that if there are too many mistakes in the first edition, the idea is to obviously improve the second one. Well, thank you very much. I don't know whether you want to make any comments or ask any questions about social policies. Maybe we can leave them for later if you like. We'll carry on with the second block, which is going to be... Nacho's going to tell us about peace, security, cooperation and migration.
Bueno, este es el último bloque. Podríamos pasar ya eso a esta fase más de debate, ¿no?
Well, we'll go through this final block and then we'll have a debate. There are three policies included in this block. They're not necessarily consistent or homogeneous. It's quite flexible, all this, and what we use these frameworks as methodological frameworks, but we thought it made sense to bring these policies together because they're really not part of the classic outlook. But we think that there are three policies that explain certain aspects of governance as regards the construction of peace, human rights, and also from a perspective of human and environmental safety. So we put it all together. This is probably before Pablo was saying that in social policies, social policies has been one of the easiest blocks because we've been able to use measurements and variables that fitted in with our concept. This final block is probably, on the other hand, one of the most difficult that we're having to work on. When we started to think about policies like this, there's a theoretical framework, but it's very difficult to find elements that can actually measure that theory. In practice, you have different options. So after a lot of thought, one of the decisions we made was to really simplify the amount of indicators and variables. I think this in part has to do with how this block relates to the other blocks, to the extent that we understand the concept of safety from a very wide-ranging point of view. When we talk about human and human rights safety, these cannot be understood if they're not put in relation one with the other. I'm going to tell you very briefly how we addressed each of these policies and which were the most complex areas. In case you have some kind of suggestion or comment about how to address these gaps that we have in measurement, in the measuring process. The first policy is peace and security. Now, peace and security is based on human security, and we wanted to give it an intermestic nature because we believe it has it. But this has always traditionally been looked at in terms of foreign affairs towards the outside. Security, we believe, has a lot to do with the internal side of things. A lot of this will be measured using social policy because it has a lot to do with social cohesion, equality, and social protection. But there are other elements of more domestic policy that have to do with the degree of militarization of a society. We're going to measure this within this policy. Militarization, number of soldiers, troops, as compared to the population, and military expense as compared to social expense. These are fundamental to measure this aspect. And also the weapons and the access to light weapons policy of a given country associated with the number of homicides and murders caused by guns. And we believe that this is a good way of connecting this policy, the degree of insecurity that's generated as compared to other policies like social cohesion, equality, etc. We think there's a clear relation there. So we have a domestic dimension that includes innovative aspects that are not usually included in analyses.
And then it has a more international dimension, security policy. Of course, here is where we probably face the main difficulty to land the measurement, and that is in our theoretical focus. Human security is very wide indeed compared to a more traditional focus, which is securitization. What we try to measure here is to what extent countries contribute to peace building or the reinforcement of capabilities to build peace. But we have statistics that allow us to measure other things, how countries contribute to guarantee peace in military conflicts from a securitization focus or a much more classical focus in terms of defense. And that is where we're facing a problem to see how we measure the contribution of these countries. So what do we have to do? We have to resort to standards. We are analyzing our rules. We're looking at the international rules on peace and weapons and see how that is reflected in the national legislations. And that is where we face one of our main shortfalls between our theoretical framework and elements that have to do with defensive diplomacy, which are very difficult to measure because they're not as systematized and there isn't that much information about them. So that is the main element, the main difficulty that we are encountering in terms of security. I'm not going to talk about many variables or indicators. If you want more details afterwards as to how we're measuring this, we can even project the matrix. But basically, this is the main problem that we find in the field of peace and security. Another policy that has generated created lots of problems to see how we could fit it into our analysis as cooperation policy. Of course, cooperation policy is probably one of the policies that responds best to North-South logic and to the existence of relations between developed countries and less developed countries, a reality which exists less and less or which is ceasing to exist. I think we all know this system very well. The information system is built on the basis of donors and receivers. And the in this policy, we want to measure it in terms of official aid to development. That's not how we're going to do it, because when we made the decision of making an index for all countries, this is one of the things that we have to give up. And all those aspects that have to do with aid efficacy or how cooperation policy is managed in terms of resources or transfer of resources. How have we approached this? How have we faced this difficulty? Well, we focused on two aspects. One of them is that we tried to measure cooperation policy more as a commitment to, with a contribution to global governance spaces or to global public spaces. How countries commit themselves to strengthen multilateral government spaces, like the contribution of countries to women or their contribution to the UN program for the environment. So how they contribute to configure multilateral decision-making spaces. This is one of the ways in which we focus cooperation policy, understanding that it's getting away from the classical cooperation analysis as based on the aid for development and the efficacy of that aid. And another element that we're focusing on is how that policy is structured, the political scheme within the different government systems in the different countries, for example. And this, I have to say, is one of the few cases in the index where we are generating information, collecting information, because this information is not systematized and does not exist. So we're mapping how the cooperation policy is found in government systems, whether in a specific ministry or if it's present in different ministries or if there is a secretariat in charge of that, looking at the person who is responsible for that, and also within the political structure, where is it located. Another element that we are analyzing in cooperation policy is a degree of social participation that exists on this policy. If there are bodies or spaces for decision making or for consultation where civil society organizations have a role to play, if they participate within the cooperation for development structure, regardless whether they are donor countries or receiver countries. These are the two clear axes on which we are building a cooperation policy. And here we're breaking away with how cooperation policy has been classically analyzed, but this option of making an index for all countries forced us to make this decision, but also the international development agenda. Where is it heading? That universality of the post-2015 agenda, we think, make this decision legitimate. In other words, not only it's for measurement purposes, but it's also based on theory. And the third policy is migration policy. Most probably this is the policy that has left us less satisfied in terms of measurement. And we have a problem here that we find in no other policy, because most of the migration flows, the reality of migrations, takes place at an irregular level. And it's very difficult to have information or statistics to measure or analyze this phenomenon. Our analysis is trying to focus basically on the protection of human rights of migrant groups, basically, but we have very little information to measure this, and we are aware that we won't have this information. We have a lot of good information on what the degree of protection is on the workplace, in the home, in healthcare, in education, but only for OECD countries, not for the other countries. And therefore, we have to give up that. The way we're trying to measure this policy is through the opening up of countries. to the entry of migrant people, the ease to hire immigrants, and then something that this morning at the beginning of the session, one of the participants, Marta, was telling us. We're not limiting migration policy only to migrant groups or to migration flows, but perhaps we should also talk in more exact terms of mobility policies, because asylum and refugees, well, these are some of the aspects that we're measuring. How countries are more or less inclined to grant asylum asylum for refugees. So these are the three approaches. I leave it there, and if you have any questions on any of the two blocks, or if you want us to tell you more details on how these different things are being measured, then please do let us know. Okay, any comments or contributions, doubts on Nacho's block or any of the other blocks?
Thank you. Only very briefly on peacekeeping, I think was the section called Peace and Security. It might be worth to look at the Global Peace Index, which has been published for the past several years, and I think is considered very credible. Includes a lot of countries, not just OECD countries, and exactly includes both the domestic and international dimension. On migration, you're very right that the data, even for OECD countries, are very scarce. We also have a problem with that. Within the Commitment to Development Index, what we at the moment consider is share of foreign students, or we consider share of students from developing countries. However, you might want to consider a share of foreign students on total student population, which would be the mobility aspect, as you have highlighted. But you could possibly incorporate some of the important migration international treaties, which would be the input sides of the policy. But at the moment, at the OECD and the World Bank, NOMAD Network, they're piloting a new project which might in the future bring maybe more data that we would be able to use for assessing migration policies of both sending and recipient countries.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you. Could you please pass the mic on to Iñigo? Yes, two proposals. I think we talked about it before. Indicators about violence against women. That is an indicator that collects a lot of information, really, because if you compare women in parliament and you compare it country by country, well, I think it does give you a lot of information. I don't know if you've taken that into account. And then I think it's very interesting, that proposal, very courageous proposal of that discussion we've always had. Multilateralism is one of the solutions. But perhaps you could explain a little bit more, because I'm sure that there are many countries that don't look very good, because contributions to multilateral organizations, I guess there's a very strong correlation between income and contributions to multilateral bodies. And then also, there are multilateral organizations that are not traditional ones. I don't know if you could call them multilateral, but could you explain a little bit further this Novo Bank that the BRICS are setting up? I think it's very interesting, that approach of cooperation. Can you please explain it a little bit more? two questions. 6 or 7 years ago, perhaps it doesn't exist anymore, but the last time I saw it, it looked really good, and that is the good humanitarian donor. It was 22 principles. There, its design was done to be able to measure and compare countries. I don't know if it still exists, but it was very widely accepted. And it measured the response capability and humanitarian missions and some practices in situations of international insecurity. I don't know if that is still being done, but that would be a good thing to take into account. And then I think it's really courageous, the decision of not including, I think he said A2 cooperation, that makes you radicals. And just a question out of curiosity. I understand that if you analyze donors and receivers, could there be a way of analyzing good and bad practices in a similar way? Receivers of aid, in other words, the OD sector from the point of view of donor and receiver. Maybe you can find an indicator that would measure good practices from the side of the donor and from the side of the receiver. The Paris Agenda also has some mandates for the receiver. So it would be a way of looking at both sides.
I had a question also on the social chapter. I was wondering how you were in calculating the aspects relating to informal employment, informal employment, which is a reality for a majority of the workforce, actually, in some countries. And also, maybe, I don't know if they exist, but indicators of the number of arrestations of trade union leaders and stuff like that. I don't know if that exists, but of detention of trade union leaders. On security, I was surprised not to see anything about arms sales. I mean, is it because there is, I know there are also treaties on that, maybe that could be a point of entry, but there are also, I think, maybe some public information about agreements even between countries. I can't remember. We had a publication on security a while ago in Concord, and I do remember that they were talking about a process relating to that, but it's not my field of expertise, so I can't remember. And on the cooperation level, I'm not sure I support so much the fact that you do not take in the I don't know how you call it, a donor recipient or ODA, or because I think that while on a philosophical level and on as a target, we have to move away from that concept. I think this is very much the reality of today, and I think you need to have a view on that to be able to combat it in a way. I mean, not addressing it makes it not exist in a way, which is, I'm not sure it's the right approach, but only my opinion, of course. And I was also wondering that this is a lot about structures and processes, but what about the quality of the cooperation? Is there ways to look into that? And I don't know really what I myself mean about that, but I don't know, cooperation for going to war is different than cooperation to build peace, you know? I mean, it's, I don't know, I mean, it's really simplistic what I'm saying now, but it's just to say that the quality factor in that may be interesting. And also, you were mentioning a lot about the multilateral dimension, but I was wondering whether regional integration, was there was a way of of measuring that. It's a reality in Europe, but it's also work in progress in Africa, for example. So it's something else. And in terms of migration, well, remittances, you didn't mention it. Is it something that you would look into? No. And brain drain. There were statistics somewhere about, you know, like numbers of doctors in Zimbabwe, in the city of Birmingham, being higher than the number of doctors in Zimbabwe themselves. I don't know where those statistics come from, but I think they are very telling about brain drain.
Maybe a different perspective on brain drain. You could also look into to what extent countries recognize diplomas from universities from other countries. So whether if you decide to move to Spain, whether you can actually work as an engineer, or is it because you got your degree in Bolivia that you have to work in a supermarket or something like that?
But
yeah. No. But it's indeed the discussion or how you look at it. And then on cooperation, another way of dealing with the ODA fixation is to have additional items there. And some countries, for instance, have tax breaks for individuals who want to give to civil society organizations, so they don't have to pay tax over donations like that. And that might be one example. The problem is always that you have these mini European countries that give 1% to ODA, and of course that is relevant, but it's not the whole picture. And you have a very big country like the USA who scores very low, but scores much better than European countries on non-ODA contributions via other organizations, private foundations, and I don't know what the indicators there are, but your indicators could also basically show that the picture is bigger than ODA alone. Mm-hmm.
I forgot a big issue, which I forgot to say. Maybe it fits into cooperation, I don't know, but CSO enabling environment. So the space for civil society to operate, to be legitimate in operating, to have access to funding, and all these kind of things. I think Civicus has some data on this. Is it something that you would take as part of the cooperation aspects? And in terms of migrations, and I do not know if that exists, but one of our calls is for the portability of social rights. When migrants have worked in the country and the ability to transfer the social rights and the social benefits that they have accumulated if they go back to their country of origin.
Thank you. On arms exports, I would like to add that you will very likely arrive to the point to the discovery that there is no data available, because even for the CDI for the 27 countries, we have an expert outsourced who actually looks into each country agreements that he needs to look up. There isn't a database. And some countries publish actually the number of licenses and the value of licenses opposed to the actual value of arms exports. So I think that will be a bit of an issue. I would only urge you to rethink the brain drain issue, because as many of you know, that quite a lot of researchers stand the view that there isn't such a thing as brain drain. Please consider the migration issue from a slightly different perspective. And yes, it would be wonderful to have all those indicators for migration, but there isn't a database, there isn't a source for all those information. You know, how many documents you need to fill in when you go to a particular country, how many visas, what are the visa regimes, etc. But it's not there, simply. Yeah.
Un comentario general que...
This is a general remark. Throughout all the presentations, something that really called my attention is that at the beginning, you emphasized, you underlined the fact that you took the concept of sustainability to look at the different policies. But I don't see it anywhere explicit in the areas that you're talking about. For example, in the area of cooperation, perhaps that is a new element that you could include. I think it's very interesting that you try to use a different approach. Nevertheless, I would like to know a little bit more how you would go about it. But perhaps a new element in cooperation is to see to what extent it is contributing to sustainable development. In other words, cooperation programs, cooperation actions, are they really having an impact on sustainability issues? Understood in the wide sense of the term, not only in the environmental aspect, but how it is being approached right now in the agenda. So that could be an element. And I remember a comment made by one of the chairmen of the informal working group, the open working group. And he visited us to talk about the objectives, and he told us that what they had found is that 70% of the aid or of cooperation programs are not sustainable. So they're not really contributing to sustainable development objectives. I don't know where he took the information from, but I think it's interesting, and that should be challenged. In other words, we're really promoting a cooperation that is going to contribute to this, or are we really reinforcing sustainable consumption patterns or sustainable production patterns? Perhaps that is the dimension that you should add. And also, how is it that you're going to include that sustainability dimension in the other areas? It would be interesting to know that. Okay, with regards to informal employment that Nadine was asked about, what we did here basically was to follow the instructions from the World Labor Organization. And they have an indicator that they call vulnerable employment, and they say that it's not completely satisfactory to combine it with that of urban informal employment. They have data on urban informal employment, but restricted only to urban areas or large metropolitan areas. And in developing countries, there is no data in that same database that are comparable for cities in and developed countries. So, following his suggestion, we're going to see how it works later in quantitative terms. But what we did was to establish a ratio between the occupation and unemployment rate. This occupation, it's not, both don't add to 100%. A working population that is unemployed, well, and the rest of it. So, then we combine that, because this is following instructions of the ILO, and there are some studies for regions that they have published where they do that. So that is combined with the vulnerable employment rate that they use, the ILO. And from there, you don't get the number of informal employment, but you do get an approximation of people or the amount of the population that has vulnerable jobs. We have the percentage of poor population, but we don't have it for enough countries, for the amount of countries that we would like to start with. And that is the greatest approach that we'll be able to do. Now, what we have seen, comparing just a few countries with that data, is that the numbers are very different to traditional employment numbers. So the panorama with regards to employment in the different countries is closer to what we would like to show than the pure and traditional employment rates. With regards to the inclusion of rights, rights on the job, workers' rights. We had chosen an indicator of collective bargaining and trade union participation or trade union density, but frankly, I know that we contemplated or we studied the arrest of trade union leaders linked to the vulnerability in workers' rights in some countries or non-existence of those rights in some countries, but frankly, I don't remember why it is that we have included it, but I'm going to look into it. Because when you mentioned it, I did remember that we thought back then that it was an indicator that could be very indicative of that situation. So we'll look at it again. And then, oh yes, with regards to education or employment, which could be included in both sides, diplomas, if they are recognized in different countries, somebody asked. I don't remember. I'm not going to say where, because I don't remember where I looked this up, but there was data from diplomatic sources but we didn't find an updated indicator for all countries in a given year. We didn't find it. But it could be very interesting if it did exist or if we could find it. And then with regards to sustainability that Ernesto mentioned, well, that in part is a result of two things. First of all, because it is a particularly difficult dimension to include from the quantitative point of view, because we have the limitations of the indicators, because they're done from the different approaches and there's still a lot to build on. But some of them are already working and we have included to measure that dimension in some of the policies, and we haven't mentioned because we couldn't go into the details, but I mentioned the problem of distance to schools, right? But for example, the dimension, environmental dimension, the environmental dimension of health, of health care policy, there we do include is to improve sanitation, of the World Health Organization and UNICEF, the population exposed to contamination, which tells us a lot about vulnerability linked to gender. And also there is an indicator from the ILO on the degree of inclusion of environmental policies in companies. So there are some that are more or less traditional, which are part of the indicator. The thing is that as we try to explain in this complex vision with many elements, the sustainability of the final indicator is not only found in the environmental dimension, but in the crossing of different elements. I would dare say that the decision, or using the argument that you used, I wish we had that source of 70% of projects that are non-sustainable that you mentioned, but the non-inclusion of some elements, which per se, although they've gone through development vectors without sustainability, the non-inclusion of those elements to measure the situation or the outcomes of certain policies is a decision based on a sustainability criterion. We cannot include some elements because they don't pass the sustainability criterion. That's all.
Bueno, la verdad es que
The comments, there are many very interesting and very relevant comments. The fact that I haven't gone into indicators but it's because, well, I haven't gone into detail, but some of them, those that you've mentioned, we have incorporated. Others we haven't because we haven't got data. I'll look at them all now, but we haven't been able to make the decisions we would have wanted to make and incorporate basic things because we don't have the data. So there are some large areas or large gaps. We did analyze in depth the Global Peace Index, and we like some of its components. We don't share all of it, but that index includes a lot of indicators, and we do take them into consideration. For instance, the sale of guns. There are other indicators that are of interest, and we have recovered. The only thing we've done is to discriminate between some parts of the index that don't fit in or didn't fit in because they didn't fit in with that intermastic vision or because they were in other parts of the index. But it's been a reference point in the same way that your index has been a reference. A lot has been taken out of there. It's true what you said about the migration data. In fact, I made a mistake when I said it was OECD. It's European Union. 27 countries with good data. The rest of the countries haven't got many data on social protection and migrant communities. In migration, we do include treaties, and we collect the two main treaties that there are. One is the, can't remember them now by heart, Convention on Migrant Workers and Refugees and the and relatives. I can't remember the names, but the two big conventions on migration. Also the indicator on sales of guns. We're still working on that because we don't know whether we're going to be able to use it like we want to. We want to indicate that countries that sell weapons that to other countries that have a high degree of military investment as compared to their social expense. We want to use that indicator, and that's the approach we're gonna use. And as regards some of the questions are associated with cooperation policy, we don't turn our back on that because we think that it's not important and it shouldn't be measured, and we have to use another paradigm. And that cooperation is not relevant, cooperation policy. I think you've hit it on the head when you've said about symmetry, the symmetry or lack of symmetry between the countries and the asymmetry between donors and receptors or receivers, and how donors impose their conditions in spite of the Paris Agenda when it talks about mutual responsibility. That's one reason why we'd like to analyze the cooperation policy and focus on the least or less technical aspects of cooperation. But we believe it's very difficult because of how that is designed and the availability of data. We've got 27 donor countries at the end of the day. We've got to rule out the most relevant data on migration policy because they only refer to 27 countries. On the North-South cooperation, we have no data. So this is a methodological obstacle that we can't really overcome. We want cooperation to be included in the index. We think it's important, relevant, means a lot, but it's very limited because, bearing in mind our approach, and the same happens with the good humanitarian donor indicator or index that was developed by DARA. The indicator that was developed by DARA for many years was okay, was very good, but that finished in 2011, and that project has died. And I hope it, by the way, the same doesn't happen to many other indexes that are still current. But it's a difficult problem. I was thinking aloud It's a joke. Well, for us, this has not been easy. It's not been easy. We don't want to revolutionize. We're not trying to be revolutionary or radical, but we do believe that there's a change of agenda, cooperation policy. We're redefining the concept of aid itself, so we'll see what happens and how that can fit in the indicator. But because of the nature, asymmetrical nature of the whole situation, we can't include that. We've really looked at it from every single possible angle to see how we can incorporate this. For instance, to see whether we could spread out responsibility in the decision-making process among donors and receptors. For instance, if a country gives X number of or X percentage for social cooperation or solidarity, whatever, and what percentage that country gives to other areas. Now, the reason we decided not to do this is because the nature of the system of aid, the decision-making process is not a shared responsibility, really. Those who make the decisions are the donors, mainly. It doesn't happen, it's not the same everywhere. It doesn't happen in countries that don't depend on aid. But what do we do with countries that practically are not independent in terms of what they do with their aid? Because they depend on it so greatly that they can't do anything about it. We thought it was this distorted the picture. So we thought it had the inclusion of that analysis had more weak points than strong points, but we're open to proposals in terms of cooperation policy. But at this time, we see that there are more obstacles than anything else. So it's quite complex. The quality of aid could also be measured, but it's very difficult to include it in an index like this. As regards remittances, we've looked at this and thought hard about whether to include it or not, but there's another problem of availability of information. There is no information for many countries about remittances. We'd looked at the possibility of seeing to what extent a country makes it easy for people to remit, to send remittances. And what we see at the end of the day is that there's no information. That's not public. That's not public, it's private. People send money, the state's not involved in that. So there's no information. And we decided that we wouldn't include that either. The brain drain is a complex debate, and we've got no closed position or definite position about that. We're not including it right now. What we are including is how countries develop policies to retain talent. But we're not analyzing the situation from the point or country of destination, but from the source country, country of origin, what countries do to retain their talent. Different sectors of the population with different qualifications. But the proposal of Niels is very interesting. What level of flexibility is there for recognizing foreign qualifications? This is, quite frankly, something that we'd forgotten about. And I think it's very important and very interesting. It might be a parameter that we should bear in mind.
También junto con Nacho la política de migraciones y encontramos una base de datos que no me acuerdo.
Yeah, we've got a database. I can't remember now the name of it. Do you remember? If you, it's a perspective which has to do about with what we were talking about. To what extent countries made it possible for migrants to vote? The position of men and women, I don't know whether it was that specific point that you mentioned was included, but there were a whole series of parameters to look at how countries protect minorities, the access to nationality, double nationality. But what is the, all those parameters are coherent with our approach, but we haven't got the data for more than 27 countries. So it's not enough, because that's the limit. Really, the approach is the approach that we have. But our limitations have to do with the practical reality of things, not with the approach. Good, I'll carry on. If I forget something, in you go, I haven't forgotten your question, but it's a bit difficult, I'll leave it for last. If I've forgotten anything, remind me. I think you, Blandine, were talking about social participation. I've touched upon that maybe too quickly, but that's one of the points that we're contemplating in cooperation policy. Not so much what mechanisms there are of funding, of financing, and what's the way of civil society and management of aid to development, but what we are doing is trying to identify, and we're looking for information. I didn't know about that initiative that you've mentioned. Shirley now will tell us. She is working on a gathering of information. She might have more to tell us about that. What we are doing is identifying in what countries there is a formal space or possibility for civil society to participate in the management of cooperation. That changes from country to country. In some countries, they're purely cosmetic operations, and in other countries there are true possibilities for cooperation. For instance, in Spain there are formal channels for participation, and we're looking at that. Shirley, please, the microphone. We need the microphone. We got in touch with Civic Bus, and they said that they'd done surveys and studies of specific countries, but no indicators on countries in the whole world, so we had to rule that out. That was the reason. Yes. I'm going to approach what the international space is. We're not looking at certain regional scenarios or new scenarios of international convergence or new initiatives like certain banks are doing and things. But what in certain policies that have to do with integration processes and that have become transnational, we assess that policy. For instance, in the case of these policies, that's not the case. It's more in other policies. We do look at, for instance, the Europeization of the Spanish policies or the regionalization of certain policies, but in terms of construction of governance spaces, we're really using the United Nations scenario space. That is where we're measuring the effort of countries to contribute to multilateral bodies while remaining open to other possibilities, and we're measuring the contribution of countries to sustainability. Specifically in global governance, the spaces that are included within the environmental block or area. And in global governance is where more progress has been made as compared to other areas where countries don't agree so much because obviously the threats are greater. So I think that sometimes easier to have global governance in some areas than in others. Not through the analysis of cooperation policy. I think that covers the situation. This is a comment that doesn't have to do with this block specifically, but is associated to something that Natalia has said, has to do with data indicators. I don't know whether it's relevant now. Yes, tell us. We were talking about it at lunch, the logic, if I understood Pablo correctly, of all these set of indicators, there's about 110, 120, and right now we know that for those 110, 120 indicators, there are 80 countries for which all those indicators could be filled in. I was saying this because I know that any statistician would say that this is not the right way to do it, but my opinion is that I would not magnify the difficulties. I would not magnify the fact that data cannot be compared as a result of minor methodological problems at the expense of losing good indicators that we would have and need, and good data that we can use, ruling out different A friend of mine was telling me that the differences can sometimes be so small that it really doesn't matter, that it's still worthwhile to continue with the operation, because something in the Eurostat or the OECD, there are very good data for some things that cannot be found, data that cannot be found for other regions, but there are attempts by some regional banks, for instance, to reproduce those indicators for other countries, and sometimes the methodological differences or problems are not that great. What I'm trying to say is we shouldn't be too the approach shouldn't be too purist. We shouldn't be too strict, because we might lose out on information that's very useful. If you've got statistical support, maybe there's a series that is very, very good and you've got it for 40 or 50 countries, and it might be worthwhile using that and see what can be done with the countries where that data is not available.
Bueno, si, si.
If there are no further comments, that's a very good comment to introduce the next presentation by Hector and Shirley that are going to talk about this. I just want to say something that we're happy with at the moment, and that is that the statistics company that we're working with doesn't seem to be too fundamentalist in their approach. They're very good statisticians, but their working method, they tell us that once they've analyzed individually each of the indicators, and they've built up the synthetic model, they will propose three options between a range, a more fundamentalist sort of extreme, and a more flexible extreme. So they'll try to give us three alternatives, or several alternatives, within a margin, without, you know, while at the same time being rigorous and strict. So we've got room to maneuver there. We will have. Now, Hector and Shirley will address us now.
Esto terminamos tiene media hora, porque he dicho a las 5 y son 4 y media. Gracias.
esta parte vamos a intentar explicar un poco.
In this part we're going to try and explain the process of treatment of the indicators and give you some examples of small examples of some types of indicators and show you what we've faced on the ground, so to speak.
La propia presentación. Vale, esto es un poco la idea de
this is the
cómo debería ser el indicador ideal, ¿no? Que cumpliese todas, o sea, no todos, no solo cada indicador, pero sí en cada matriz individual de cada política debería recoger todo.
And I'm going to look at whether I should collect this in. We're going to look at each policy and what we've included and how we've complied with the intermestic approach. And in reality, that is quite impossible sometimes. The reality is that there's a series of indicators that give us an approximate perspective of certain measurements that we want to represent, and some of those measurements go beyond the matrix itself entered into other matrices. So we always play with that way of approaching what we want to measure, and then we use the most micro, so to speak, approach, and then we go back to the macro approach to look at the full picture. This is a representation of the process. This is what Pablo, Nacho, Natalia have asked for. But our approach is a different matter. Another matter is the existing data, and then another different matter will be what the statisticians give back to us when they finish their work. So there'll be a final set of indicators, which I don't know how many. We'll be talking about 100, around 100, and then there's a process of simplifying things by getting rid of indicators that are duplicated or very similar. Some problems of having to do with refining the data, and we don't know at the end of the day what the situation will be exactly, but it will be rather more simple than what we have now. When it comes to addressing these issues, one of the things we want to do, it's not a question of being methodologically perfect, because we cannot be, but we want to be as honest as we can, extremely honest in dealing with each indicator, its weak points. We think it's the best way to do things. If you think we'll look at the matrix, I don't know whether you can see this. This is a very busy slide, but this is part of the matrix. You can see the indicators that we're talking about. You can have a look at this in case you have doubt about what has been presented. This is not closed completely. Commercial is in grey until now. And as you can see, there are some spaces in white. Some have not yet been decided upon, and others.
No es en este caso, pero.
And then in this case, when it comes to talking about education or health, it's a question of fiddling around with the indicators sometimes until you can fit them in. But sometimes it's easier, sometimes we leave it blank because we think it's properly, the indicator's already represented by others, or because we believe that it's not so important in that area. And it doesn't warrant such fine tuning, because the idea is to distort the matrix as little as possible. Social protection is in white, is blank, because we are now working on it to try and finish defining it. There's something that Pablo has said, and I'd like to clarify. when we it comes to measuring gender violence or LGBT violence or violence against women, it's a problem. Those measurements are really based on reported cases, cases that have been reported to the police. So we decided not to include that because that's not representative of the violence against women or LGBT minorities or whatever. This is the process, this is where we are. This is in green, you see the indicators that have been revised by the statisticians with some problems that they've had when the source wasn't too clear. In red, these are compound indicators that have been reviewed differently, and in white is part of my workload for this weekend. We now can look at specific indicators, and then Shirley will explain this and I'll continue. We've selected a set of examples, like, for instance, legislation against gender violence. We find this in the Justice Matrix. There are data on 94 countries. We've chosen in this chart a series of randomly chosen a series of countries to show you what the process is. For instance, there are countries where there is legislation on domestic violence, sexual harassment, but nothing about rape, conjugal rape, for instance. So we've considered countries where legislation exists and we've given them 1 point. Countries without legislation, we've given them naught or zero to sort of penalize them, penalize the fact that they haven't got it. In this case, we see that the sources are 12, report of 2012 on the advance and progress of women in the world in search of better justice. This is a second example, which is science and technology. An assessment of the institutions devoted to research. In this case, the data were taken from the Global Competitiveness Report for 2014 issued by the World Economic Forum. And this is an indicator that gives us data on only 144 countries. They have a score of 1 to 7. 7 is the best that is applied to the quality of institutions.
In other cases, to be able to show you this information, well, we had to mix two indicators. Two indicators so that we can obtain this information. In this case, we're talking about healthcare and the coverage of the healthcare system, and we measured how universal the healthcare system is in a country. There is no base that can make a distinction between universal and non-universal health care. But we did, with WHO information, we have, on the one hand, a first indicator that shows what is the barrier, the financial barrier for households when having access to health care. And the second one is a rating indicator that represents 2.28 doctors, nurses, and what's it called? Another health personnel for every 1,000 inhabitants. And if it's yes, we can make a distinction between different accessibility levels related to financial aspects, which is what you see there in percentages. Since the data comes from estimates, we don't want to use the specific data and make a distinction based on that. We will probably do it in quintiles, but we'll have to talk about it about this with the statisticians. But this is an inverse or reverse indicator. 100% of expenses by people would have a lower points because it is a barrier for accessing the system. And the next one is the problem we had in including Gini. We had the problem of standardization of the data and allocating causality to the fiscal system. So what we found was that SALT, a data standardized database of inequalities, which we think is a very good resource, and it allows us to measure the net amounts, and that gives us the possibility of measuring part of that effect of the fiscal system on inequality. This is another case that we found when measuring equality leaves, maternity and paternity leaves. We think that having more maternity leave is something positive. Having more paternity leave is positive. But what we want to reflect is that difference between both does tell us something. In this case, if we consider that when paternity leaves, the minimum legal are less generous, it causes perverse effects, which means that caring for the children is a responsibility of women. And it means that the women tend to leave their jobs more than males. And this is why we think that if there's a bigger difference between maternity and paternity leaves, that is negative. And if you want later, I can tell you about the failures. One of them has to do, because we know that there are cases, but we don't know if they cover all the possibilities. In the case of taxes or levies to financial transactions, there are many proposals on the table, but we don't know if it includes all the proposals there are in the different countries. And the same thing happens with the gender-focused budgets. We have some specific cases, but we don't know if the cases we have are all the cases that there are in countries. So we think it would be unfair to quantify between yes and no, they do or they don't exist, because we don't know if we have all the information. And the next one is very simple. There aren't enough cases. The problem of collective bargaining, we have 29 cases, very few cases. And then with some social protection indicators, as you can see, the matrix is empty. We had a case for Bangladesh, which I think was the only study that was carried out. And then we have the false friends, or the, yes, false friends, which is used here a lot to explain what to learn English in school. And it's the indicators that we think measure something, but actually is not measuring that. For example, peace operations, when looking at peace operations, they weren't really peace. They were referring to the number of police forces that there are in countries in conflict, which, well. And we also found some more data in different databases that were given by NGOs, but biased data with regards to human beings, democracy, social participation, political prisoners. All of that is quite biased towards anti-capitalist countries, let's put it that way. And it's always the same countries, Korea, well, North Korea, Venezuela, and the rest of it. And then lots of indicators that had very few data. And perhaps we could use them, but since they were so few in terms of immigration and social aspects, and as Hector said, in foreign affairs, we find a database. Well, I'm not going to mention the name of the database on cooperation in countries in conflict, which referred to the same thing, peace missions. And then when you looked at one and the other database, it was always the same thing, the number of police forces, the number of international observers, the number of troops. So it's not part of the vision that we want to have.
damos paso a unas preguntas y luego intervendrá Pablo.
Okay, questions and then Pablo will take the floor again.
Bueno, pues vamos a ir por cerca. Bueno, muchas gracias por aguantar hasta ahora y os dejamos con
Pablo. Okay, so we leave you with Pablo. Just a couple of words to close only. Well, of course, I have to thank everyone for your participation, for your patience, and for the interest shown. We already said it before, but each and every one of the contributions, questions, suggestions are extremely, extremely useful for us. We're having now the syndrome, I don't know how to call it, syndrome of the people who are locked in a room and need fresh air and some oxygen. And you really have given us a lot of oxygen. And I'm sure that everything you told us is going to have a very positive impact on our work. I particularly would like to thank for those of you who come from far away for the effort you made to come here with this appropriate weather. We also need to thank the people from the Eco Room that have lent us this venue. I think it's an excellent place to meet because it's a very good representation of sustainability. In the future, most places will look like this venue. Of course, with a little bit of air conditioning, that won't be too bad either. But also, the lunch was very healthy, healthy food. It was fair trade food. I mean, it was also very much in line with what we're trying to achieve. So we promise to be in touch with you in the future, with each and every one of you. This is not the end of it. Sooner or later, we will be sending you more documentation, and we hope to have your help in the future by the end of the month of September or at the beginning of October for when we have worked more on the project, and so we can see whether it works or not. All right, so thank you very much, and thank you very much to Jose. Thank you for your very hard job in organizing this event. Thank you all.